أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All praise be unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the sustainer, la ilaha illallah. I testify that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we send our greetings, our salutations, our love to our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to his perfect and pure family, to his perfect and his best of companions, and all those who follow his sunnah until the end of time. May we be amongst them. Ameen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us in this waqt of Jumu'ah. Let it be a light for us for the week to come and a forgiveness for the sins of last week, as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam teaches us. Ameen. Walhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, it's a great honor for me to be here. I've spoken, alhamdulillah, at various places, but this masjid has a special significance for me because I used to be a student Islamia. Spent a lot of sleeping time at that side of the masjid. And now, subhanAllah, I'm giving the lecture for the very first time in this masjid, which was like my home for a long, long time, alhamdulillah. And before I begin, I must confess something. That I knew about this lecture a while ago, and I prepared a wonderful lecture for the youth, all about the youth, and I found out 10 minutes ago there will be no youth. Alhamdulillah. So this is the most unprepared I've been since my matric exam. Takes me back. Right. So I don't want to give the same lecture because it would be, I feel that it would not be appropriate for the jama'ah. And I asked a few of my friends who are here, what should I speak about? One said, speak about intimacy. We are, the kids are gone, raise the age restriction level. We talk about intimacy and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, it's part of the deen, but we'll get to that another time. I want to talk, inshallah, appropriately. If we look at, yesterday I was sitting there. Today I would be sitting on this side of the masjid. Tomorrow I might be sitting on the chair, or I might be here in front with my janazah salah. And this is the nature of time. I want to talk about time in a lecture which I call beating the unbeatable game. Beating the unbeatable game, not marriage, beating the unbeatable game. I'm not talking about marriage. I'm talking about, the brothers laughed enough, I'm talking about time. That all of us are competing against a clock with ourselves. And Allahu A'lam, we don't know when that clock might come to an end. And whether we will win or lose. And in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to all of us, wal asr, innal insana ladhi husr. By time, O insan, you are fighting time and you're always going to lose. Time will always beat you. But there is a way to beat time. There is a way to beat this game that has no way of winning it. There's only one way to win the game of time. Subhanallah, this beautiful ayah and Surah Al-Hadid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and think about our life. Most of us here, we've gone through these stages. This one ayah in the Quran describes the stages of our life. How we go through. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'lamu, ya insan, understand, know, annama al-hayata dunya, that this dunya life, innama al-hayata dunya, la'ibo, it begins with play. And la'ib is used to describe what small kids, toddlers do. You begin with la'ib, you play with toys, with games. Walahu, and then amusement. Lahu, amusement, is a more sophisticated type of play. Not the play of children, it's the teenage playing. The amusement of wasting time, that is for a more sophisticated older person. So you start off playing with toys, then you go through a stage of amusement, wazina, and then a stage of trying to look beautiful, attracting the opposite sex. وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ, and then competition and boasting between you. بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ, and together as much as you can. فِي الْأَمْوَالِ, in wealth and power and status. وَالْأَوْلَادِ, and in children. All of us go through the stages. Playing with toys, then going for amusement, then looking and beautiful, focusing on our bodies to attract a partner. Then we compete and boast with one another as to our bank accounts, the cars we drive. And then we look at our kids, our future, our kids must be the best. This is our life, and then we die. And that's it, we die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an example of a flower in this ayah, that it looks so beautiful, but we know that flower will only last for how long? A week, 2 weeks, and then it'll disappear. And all our effort and focus is on this that will not last forever. In another beautiful surah, or a surah that should make us afraid, and we all know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-haakumut takathur, that the Competition, the rat race of the dunya, is keeping you diverted. It's keeping you blind. It's keeping you unaware. Hatta zurtumul maqabir, until the day you enter the qabr, will the blinders come off? Will you be made aware? This dunya, this rat race, keeps you so busy and so blind until you get to the qabr. Kalla sawfa ta'lamun. Then you will understand what this life was all about. The night you and I enter that qabr, will the reality hit us? They say, and Sa'alim, he says this, that it doesn't matter who wins the rat race because you're still a rat. Therefore, this race keeps you blind. This race continuously, it deceives you. Until you enter the qabr will the deception end. So all of us, subhanAllah, where are we in this ayah? Where are we in terms of our time? Do you know the life expectancy globally is under the age of 70? Around 70 or so. So if you've reached the age of 35, you've clocked halfway. And we know the first half is always better than the last half. The last half of your life will be sickness, old age, people will pass away, disease. This will be the last half of your life. If you've passed that point, then we are on our way out, subhanAllah. And I don't like to give a khutbah to make people sad or upset. Jummah is not a place to bring you further down, but it's supposed to pick you up and lift you up. But this is the reality. That the youth are not here. And what's left, we are not part of youth anymore. If you're still here, it's just a sign that you're not of the youth anymore. That stage of your life has gone. And the one blessing that will never ever return to you is the blessing of young age. You can become rich and poor and rich again. You can become sick and then healthy again. You can be learned and forget something and knowledge will come back. But your youth will never ever come back. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is asking us, wal asr innal insana lafi khusr. By time, you're all losing out. The great tabi'i, Hassan al-Basri, says, O insan, know that you are but a collection of moments. Each time a moment is lost, part of you disappears. How many of our moments are left? So when we start looking at our life, and we look at the last 30, 40, 50, 60 years, and we ask, Ya Allah, what is my account with you like? If I were to compare what I am supposed to have been done, what I am supposed to achieve on this dunya, if I'm at the age of 35, have I completed half of my obligations to you, Ya Allah? Am I halfway there in terms of my account with you, Ya Allah? Most of us will feel so despondent. We'll think about the decades that were lost without remembering Allah. And I speak to myself first. How many salawat have we all missed? How many days have we spent where not one moment was Allah remembered, but we were in haram? Have those days been cleaned and purified, cleansed? Or will we see it only on the day of Qiyamah? Shaitan, of his trickery, is that when the believer becomes aware of his place with Allah and he wants to reform himself, he gives you a sense of paralyzing regret. You feel so bad and so far from Allah that he says, Akhi, Haji, 70 years you didn't make salah, now you want to make salah when you got the diagnosis with cancer, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure all those who are ill. Now you want to come back to Allah, Allah will never accept you now. You've wasted your life with me, Allah is not going to accept you. La, this is part of the tricks of shaitan. Because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this is probably my most favorite hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, O Bani Adam, you sin against me by night and by day. Every day, every night you sin against me. But if you come back to me daily and you ask for forgiveness, I will forgive you. Then Allah says, so this is three types of people. The first type of person, and this is the best type of person, he sins continuously and he makes tawbah continuously, and Allah does not become tired, Allah does not become frustrated and saying, how many times are you going to commit the same sin? How many times are you going to do this? No. Allah says, you sin and you ask and I forgive. Continuously without limit. This is the best kind of person. Then the hadith continues, O son of Adam, if you were to come to me with sins that filled up till the sama, meaning 70, 80 years, not one good deed, just sin, 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 and it piled up, piled up, piled up. Now it reached the sama, and you were to come to me at that point in time, I will forgive you. I will forgive you. This is the second option. The third, and this is the worst option, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, if you were to come to me on the day of Qiyamah with sins that filled the dunya. So the first guy, he committed sin and he asked for forgiveness continuously, alhamdulillah. The second guy, he lived his life sinfully, but then at the end he came right and Allah forgave him. The third guy lived his life sinfully and he died before tawbah. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you come to me with a dunya filled with sin. But if you did not commit shirk, you didn't worship anyone besides me, you didn't turn to anyone other than me, you didn't ask when you needed something to anyone, not an imam, not an ancestor, not a wali, not a karamat, nothing, you asked me directly, you come to me like that on Qiyamah, and you come to me with a world full of sin, I will come to you with a world filled with maghfirah and forgiveness. One condition, don't commit shirk. So this is the secret to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. This is who He wants you to know. He's At-Tawwab. Tawwab is the one who ever returns to you. When you come to Him, He comes to you. When you walk to Him, He runs to you. Doesn't matter how far you are in this game of time, you can still win. Even if you have 1 day left on the dunya, it's enough. 1 hour left on the dunya, it's enough to enter the highest places of Jannah. So how do we get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What are the most important things we need to do in our life to make sure that everything is correct? You know, when we think of a wali, think of mashallah, this man with a beard all the way to his chest, and you know, he's constantly in ibadah. This is a wali. You know, that he's so pious that when he makes dua, Allah accepts it as if though he has karama, he has abilities which Allah gives him through his piety. You and I will think that level of iman is out of our reach. But there's a hadith called the hadith of the wali, which means, and if you listen to this hadith, each and every one of us can be a wali of the awliya of Allah. This hadith is a recipe of how to be a wali. And it's so simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, this is a hadith Qudsi, where He says, I declare war on anyone who shows animosity to one of my awliya, one of my friends. And the way Allah is explaining now how to become a wali, He says, the way one draws near to me is through the things I have made compulsory on him. Meaning the things I love the most, the things Allah wants the most, are those five pillars of Islam. If you do the five pillars of Islam, you are more than 50% of the way a wali. That is what makes you a wali. If you're praying your five salahs, you're paying your zakah, you've gone on hajj, or making an effort to go on hajj, you fast in Ramadan, you avoid shirk, you don't worship anyone besides Allah, know, ya insan, know, O son of Adam, that you are already a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe not the best friend of Allah, but you are already a friend of Allah. So Allah says, when you do those things which I love, these are things I love the most, the fara'id, the compulsory things, then my slave draws nearer to me through additional good deeds until he reaches that level where I become the eyes with which he sees, the hands with which he grips, the feet with which he walks, that when he raises his hands and he asks, then I will provide for him with whatever he wants. So if you do those five basic things, and if you want to reform your life, and we all know that Fajr is difficult for all of us. We all know we become so busy with time that even our salah wa ayyadu billah becomes neglected. Focus on those five things first. If those five things are correct, and inshallah they are, the next question is, how do I get closer to Allah further than that? How do I go further than the basic level? And inshallah, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Allah prefers and Allah loves the deeds which are done continuously, even if they are small, versus the deeds that we do once off big time. Better to recite every day one ayah of the Quran than to wait for Ramadan and do one khatam. The man who sits 5 seconds with the Quran every day is better than the man who spends, you know, the whole month trying to do a lot. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught that the way to Jannah is not through extreme binge ibadah. Like, you know, you have binge studying. People are gonna not work throughout the year, didn't study. Now they're gonna cram everything in the night before the exam. This is not the sunnah. This is not the way. Rather, consistent small ibadah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught, and this is the secret to beating time. There's a way where you can do one deed which is multiplied by thousands of months of good deeds, of rewards. These things are called the shortcuts to Jannah. And usually when I give this talk, I actually hand out these pages with about 20 simple, easy to do things. If you implement them in your life, just one of them, not all 20, takes you less than 2-3 minutes, it will give you massive rewards. For example, what? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the one who, when he completes his compulsory prayer and he recites Ayatul Kursi, which is like 30 seconds. Every salah, you make a point, when I'm done, I will sit there for that 30 seconds to recite Ayatul Kursi, Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayyul qayyum. Nothing prevents him from entering Jannah. The only thing stopping him from getting to Jannah is his death. The only thing stopping him from Jannah is his death. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, there are three types of people, and one of them that gets the guarantee of Allah's protection in the dunya and Jannah in the akhirah, one of those three is the man who enters his house and says, Assalamu alaikum, to his family. Simple. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that if you ghusl on the day of Jumu'ah and you instruct your wife to ghusl as well, in fact the hadith says, and you cause her to ghusl as well, there's a different meaning as well there, but if you make her ghusl as well and you come to the masjid early before the imam and you sit close to the imam, then every step you took to the masjid is counted as 1 year of fasting and 1 year of tahajjud. Simple. Can you do a year of fasting and you have tahajjud? No. But you can ghusl and come to the masjid early and ask your wife to ghusl as well. Subhanallah. Easy thing to do. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, whoever makes this small dua in the morning, and we'll try to memorize it, Raditu billahi rabba. Oh Allah, I am pleased with you as my Rabb. Wa bil Islami deena, and with Islam as my way of life. Wa bi Muhammadin nabiyya, and with Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as my Nabi. If you recite this dua, Raditu billahi rabba, wa bil Islami deena, wa bi Muhammadin nabiyya Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you recite this one time in the morning, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, I guarantee you, I will take you by the hand on the day of Qiyamah and enter you into Jannah. Just one of these ad'iyah, the man who does that pujis, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, after salah, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, if you do that daily, then I guarantee that all your sins will be forgiven, even if they are like the foam of the sea. The one who says salawat on Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he just says, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. If you recite that, what do you get the reward? Number one, you join Allah in salawat, because Allah is giving salawat continuously. You join the malaika, inna Allah wa malaika. Allah and the malaika are making salawat, you'll be with them. And when you make one salawat, 10 salawat is put on you. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will be informed. You'll get like an SMS. Muhammad has just made salawat on you. Ahmad, Fatima made salawat on you. That's why some people, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will know them on Qiyamah because of how much salawat they sent to him. And he will respond to your salawat. So you make one salawat, you get 10 sins removed. 10 darajat raised up. 10 rewards given to you. Barakah in your wealth. Protection on the day of Qiyamah. How many times, how easy to make salawat? You make 100 salawat, 1,000 sins forgiven, 1,000 levels raised up. You can do that. The best time to do it is in traffic. Right? The best time to do it in traffic. You have to sit there, rather put the radio off and say 5 minutes of Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. These are the shortcuts to Jannah. Nabi Sallam taught us that Jannah is obtained through doing the compulsory things and consistently doing one of these easy things. So alhamdulillah, there's about 20 or so things that if you'd like to know more, you can speak to me. It's on our masjid website as well. You can download this page, the shortcuts to Jannah. And subhanallah, like any time in any game, in any business, we lose focus on our objective. We lose focus because life takes its toll on us. We become so busy in paying the bills and seeing to the kids and, seeing to our businesses, seeing to our health, all these things, and we forget why we are here. We know we are here. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I did not create you, O insan and jinn, except that you should worship me alone. That when you need something, you ask me directly. And in return, what do we get? Not just Jannah. We know about Jannah, but I want you, inshallah, and myself, and I conclude with this beautiful hadith once again. This is what we should be working for. This is why we should be making salah, standing up for Fajr. Why do we do it, Ya Allah? Not just because Allah tells us we have to do it, but there should be something for us, Ya Allah. What do I get in return for all these ibadat, for making this effort, Ya Allah? You know, when we enter Jannah, inshallah, and we'll all be there, inshallah, ameen. Qiyamah is on a Friday, right? It's on a Friday. This is when Qiyamah happens. So inshallah, we enter Jannah Saturday. And from Saturday until the next Friday, and there's time in Jannah. Jannah has a calendar and there's weeks and years. There will be 7 days in the week. And on Fridays, there will be a Jumu'ah. So Saturday, you can imagine the party. Saturday night in Jannah, the first Saturday night. You know, subhanAllah, you can imagine the party that's going to happen there. All of us are invited. All of us, you have an invitation if you want to. But that's not the highlight of Jannah. Not the Hurul Ains or the palaces or the shopping markets in Jannah. And there will be shopping markets in Jannah. When you walk out and the wind touches you, you become more beautiful. Your wife will go outside, she'll come back in. You say, SubhanAllah, did you have a makeover? No, just the wind of Jannah blew on you and you look beautiful. All these things are not the things that the height of Jannah. Why do I have to wake up for Fajr? Why do I have to fast? Why do I have to pay my zakah? Why do I have to make the effort? You make the effort, we make the effort for this. Because on Friday, there will be a Jumu'ah like this on Jannah. SubhanAllah, where is the masjid? Who will give the khutbah? Will Jibreel give the khutbah? Will Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam give the khutbah? No. Jannah has levels. And the highest level of Jannah is Firdaus. Jannatul Firdaus. This is the penthouse of Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there are four things I created with my hands in a way which befits Allah's majesty. The four things Allah created with His hands is the pen, the arsh, the throne, Nabi Adam, and Jannatul Firdaus. The other Jannahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had others to decorate it. But Jannatul Firdaus, He personally interior decorated that Jannah. And the highest apartment in Jannatul Firdaus is Wasilatu wal Fadila, where only one person will get it. And we hope and we make dua after the adhan that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will get that place. So we will not probably get there. You and I will not get that place. But we will visit that place on Yawmul Jumu'ah. On Friday, all of us will go there. Because on Fridays, the people of Jannah will be called. And they will come to the valley in the highest place of Jannah, beneath the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I want you to close your eyes and picture this. That you are called by the angels and you are walking through Jannah or flying through Jannah, and we are going up the levels and higher and higher and higher, and we'll get to the highest place in Jannah, in this valley beneath the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will sit there, and the ground will be of musk, perfume, the ground will be of musk. We will sit on the ground. And those who are pious, the shuhada and the awliya, they will have little hills with which they will sit on. And the anbiya, they will have pillars, towers of light which they will sit. Even Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be sitting on his tower of light. SubhanAllah, there's Abu Bakr. There's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wow. And we will sit like this, waiting for what? Who will give the khutbah? Not Jibreel, not Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah azza wa jal himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will now approach the people of Jannah and he will say to us, O people of Jannah, how have you found my Jannah? Any complaints? Anyone's Hurul Ain misbehaving? Anyone's palace not in working order? And of course, subhanallah, there's no complaints in Jannah. So, ya Allah, we have found your Jannah perfect, ya Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to you and me, and there's an invitation for us to get there. If we get through this dunya just with ease, these 35 years that are left, these 10 years that are left, that's waiting for you, O insan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, what else can I give you, O people of Jannah? And say, ya Allah, we have asked and been given everything to the point where our needs are exhausted. We don't have anything left to ask. So Allah will subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, ask me more. Ask me, who else? We say, ya Allah, we have nothing left to ask you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then teach us things that we don't know about. Allah will say, you know, in the dunya, you only get till an iPhone 7. In Jannah, you get up to 70. You didn't even know it exists. Don't you want this? We'll say, yes, we want this and we want that. Things we never knew about, Allah will show it for you. And then after Allah had given us, Allah will say, what else can I give you, O people of Jannah? We will say, ya Allah, there is nothing left I can ask. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to you and to me and to all of us, our family, and we will sit and we hope we sit like this in Jannah. Then Allah will say, now people of Jannah, I want to give you something which I have not given to any creation before. Something even better than all the stuff of Jannah. And what is that, ya Allah? What can be better than your Jannah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then remove the barrier between us and Him, and He'll allow us to look at Him directly with our eyes. And when we see Allah, we will forget everything of Jannah. And Allah will say, this is the greatest reward I could give a creation. And the only creation that has ever been will be given this reward is for us to look at Allah directly. That's why we wake up for Fajr. That's why we come to the masjid. Why we give that little bit in that box for the masjid. For this reason, so that we can be there, ya Allah. May we all be there. Ameen. May we one day boast and brag and say, remember that day we had Jumu'ah in the dunya, we spoke about this time, we are here now, we've made it. We have made it. Just a few years of a little bit of sacrifice. And when we beat this game of time, and Allah, and we recite the surah that we all know, Wal Asr, by time, إِنَّمَا الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, that mankind is at a loss, except إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those who believe and do good deeds, وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ, they believe in Allah, they don't commit shirk, and they do the best of deeds as they can, to the ability, and they advise others to do good, and then they are patiently waiting, doing that continuously until they meet Allah, you've beaten time. That is the secret to beating this unbeatable game. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in the time that we have. May He forgive us for the mistakes that we've made. And may we be united with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like we spoke about in Jannah. Ameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa salam al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.